So what are the specifications then for the low pass filter? Span edge 1, stop span edge is the minimum of mod LS1 and mod SL2. The one which is closer is important. That puts us more stringent transition band. Tolerances carried as they are. Pass band tolerance take the more stringent of the two pass band tolerances. If they are different, of course, if they are the same, there's no problem. Just take that tolerance as it is. The stop band tolerance carried as it is. Pass band and stop band nature carry as they are. Equilibrium or monotonic as they are. Naturally, you can't have different kinds of natures for the two pass bands or two stop bands in the band pass and band stop filter. They have to be carried as they are. Finally, yes, please, there's a question. So, the question is, when we design, we are ultimately going to design with the same tolerance. Yes, we are going to, are we going to design with the same tolerance? Yes, indeed, we are going to design with the same tolerance, but that tolerance could come from initially different tolerances. That means that obviously when you have different tolerances, one of the tolerances is more stringent than the other. There is a well-ordering principle between tolerances, which is not there between natures. One nature is not better than another nature, or more difficult than another nature. And secondly, one nature cannot transform into another nature. You see, unlike tolerances. Tolerances, if you have definitely obeyed a tolerance of 0.1, you obey the tolerance of 0.12. But that's not true with natures. So you can possibly have different tolerances and satisfy both of them by taking the more stringent one. But you can't do that for natures. So, the nature must be the same, but the tolerances can be different. Yes, there's a question.
Omega 0 can fall outside omega S1 and omega S2.
So the question is, can omega, that's a good question. Can omega naught fall outside omega S1 to omega S2? That's very interesting. Now you see, omega naught is the geometric mean of omega P1 and omega P2. So all that we can say is that it is between omega P1 and omega P2. But then, of course, you can, yes, in principle, choose omega S1 and omega S2 so that it is just on one side of this geometric mean. In principle, yes, it's possible, but in practice, that would be very rare. But then there's trouble. If you do that, then you have the whole, all this transformation goes haywire. That means if we do indeed put omega s1 and omega s2 just on one side of the geometric mean, then we have trouble in this transformation. That's a good question. So, you know, can omega s1 and omega s2, you know, of course, you're free to choose it anywhere between omega p1 and omega p2. And then omega naught squared is omega p1 times omega p2. So, it's the geometric mean. But if you choose omega s1 and omega s2 on one side of the geometric mean between omega p1 and omega p2, then this design procedure falls flat. You can't do this. Because both the mapping of omega p1 and omega s1 and omega s2 will come on the same side of the low pass frequency axis. So then, in fact, I leave this to you as, you know, a food for thought. What would you do? Can you change your strategy a little bit if indeed this pathological situation arises? Right? So I put this, this is a good question that has been asked, and we'll put that as a challenge. In the pathological case, omega s1 and omega s2 being on the same side, of omega naught, what can one do? One would need, of course, to modify this procedure. Now that we are anyway discussing challenges, I would like to put one more challenge before the class. Another challenge is, for the same low pass specifications, show that the Chebyshev filter order is always less than equal to the Butterworth filter order n. What I mean by the same low pass specifications is only tolerance. Tolerance is same, and the passband, stopband edges are the same. Of course, the natures are different. That means you are asking for an equiripple passband and a monotonic stopband, and putting the same passband edge and stopband edge, and the same tolerance. And then you ask for a monotonic passband and a monotonic stopband with the same passband edge, same stopband edge, and same tolerances. And you find the order in both these cases. And the challenge is to show that the Chebyshev order will always be less than or equal to the Butterworth order. So it's very interesting. There's a reason, therefore, why we would choose one nature or the other. But I told you that filter design is essentially a game of approximating the ideal. And approximations always involve compromises. Nothing comes for free. So, it might seem that when you choose an equiripple passband, you should always be doing better. Why at all should you use a monotonic passband if the order is more? The answer lies in the phase response, what you brushed under the carpet. So, a phase response of the Chebyshev filter happens to be worse in many ways. And worse in what way? Worse in the sense of group delay and phase delay. You would like the phase delay and the group delay to be as constant as possible over the passband, at least over the passband anyway. And that poses a problem. So, the, you know, in fact, it would be interesting. It's not easy to prove this. I mean, you know, it's a little involved. But one should, in one's, the designs that one would do in this course, you would, when you actually go through a design for the Butterworth or the Chebyshev filter, it would be definitely worthwhile to plot the phase response for, you know, in fact, in the class, different people would perhaps look at Butterworth designs and Chebyshev designs. And therefore, it would be worthwhile to plot the phase response in different cases and compare the phase responses. It would also be worthwhile to take the same specifications and compare the orders that one is getting for the Butterworth filter and Chebyshev filter to verify the truth of what one has been saying here in this challenge. So that would be an interesting thing to do. Anyway, so much so then for... Yes, please, the question.
When we consider the bandpass filter,
yes,
we have defined omega 0 and the bandwidth with respect to the bandpass edge, omega p1 and omega.
Yes, yes.
Why don't we do the same when we go for...
So that is an interesting question. In fact, maybe the question is, you know, when you took the bandpass filter, you had used omega, the passband edges, to define the omega naught, the center frequency, omega naught squared. So why can't you do the same thing for the band stop filter? That's a very good question. In fact, maybe that's just an answer to a challenge that I posed. So anyway, I would certainly urge you to reflect on what has been suggested. The suggestion is that instead of using omega p1, omega p2 geometric mean as omega naught, could you use the geometric mean of omega s1 and omega s2 as omega naught? How would the whole design change? And that perhaps is a very interesting alternative to consider. Anyway, now we are well equipped then to design band stop filters as well. And in fact, now let's summarize the process of any kind of discrete time filter design. The overview with hindsight, as they say. Hindsight means having now traversed the territory of discrete filter design, discrete piecewise constant filter design. Of course, the first step is discrete time unnormalized specifications. This is what is given to you. This must first be transformed into normalized specifications by dividing by the sampling frequency, dividing by fs and multiplying by 2 pi. You get the normalized specs. The next step is to go from the normalized specifications to the corresponding analog filter specifications. So normalized, discrete time specs, in omega that is. We used a bilinear transform, bilinear frequency transform. Omega is tan small omega by 2, and that gives you the analog filter specifications of appropriate nature in omega. Of course, here the analog filter has the same nature. So high pass goes to high pass, band pass to band stop, band pass to band pass, and band stop to band stop, and of course low pass to low pass. The next step is to use the frequency transformation. So analog filter specs, use the frequency transform. To design, to get the specs for the corresponding analog low pass filter. So you know how to do that for the band pass filter and the band stop filter. In our method of design, we have put the passband edge at 1 and the stopband edge is chosen to be the more stringent that emerges from the frequency transformation. We have, of course, put the more stringent of the tolerances on the passband and the stopband. The nature is carried as it is. So we can now design that analog low pass filter. let's call it H analog low pass filter with the frequency variable SL. SL is the complex frequency variable in the analog low pass. And of course, now we know what to do. In fact, we have two routes that we can follow. So we have H analog low pass filter as a function of SL. Now we can either make SL equal to HS. This could be either band pass, band stop, or high pass, whichever one we desire. So we make a frequency transformation in the analog domain, and then we replace S by 1 minus Z inverse by 1 plus Z inverse, the bilinear transform, and we get the discrete H as a function of Z. This is one route that we can follow. And that's the route that we have discussed so far. But you see, there's another route. You could, in principle, replace SL by 1 minus ZL inverse by 1 plus ZL inverse. And get something in between. So make a bilinear transformation first, and then replace ZL inverse by some H discrete Z and come there. You could also do that in principle. That means for each of these three kinds of filters, the high pass, the band pass, and the band stop, you could conceive of a discrete transformation taking you from ZL inverse to Z, or Z inverse as you like, Z inverse really. Now the exercise for you is, work out this discrete transformation H dz for all three cases, high pass, and band stop. And a corollary to that question is, observe carefully the nature of this transformation. Think of this transformation. Of course, we expect that transformation to be rational. Couldn't be irrational. Now, if it's a rational transformation, you could think of it as a rational system in its own right. What properties does that system have? Is the question I leave to you as an exercise. With that then, we are now all set to carry out filter designs. We are in a position to design the filters that we've been assigned, whether band pass, band stop, or high pass, right from the discrete filter specifications, right up to the discrete system function. Of course, the infinite impulse response filter can now be designed. We shall now, therefore, actually we should now individually proceed to design the filters that we've been assigned, and from the next lecture we shall commence our discussion on the design of finite impulse response filters. So with that, now we are well equipped, and we all urge one another to design the infinite impulse response filters that we are required to. Thank you.